Yet it is a great progress on the finish lasting survey itself. So here, let's consider relations between capacity metrics and supergravities. So probably, you know well the old result shown by Mr. et al. So if the target spacetime is given by a solution of type 3 supergravity, so then the Kappa invariance is automatically ensured. So this is a result shown by Mr. et al. In 1985. So actually the inverse was conjectured in the papers, but there was no proof. And actually this inverse should be modified like this. So this is a new result shown by Seifi and Wu in 2016. So by starting from Kappa invariant, which was in theory from a arbitrary background, and by directly solving the Kappa symmetry constraint, they succeeded in driving the equations of motions of the general supergravity. So now we have the fundamental origins for the general supergravities. So both the set of the equations of motions was obtained by solving the Kappa symmetry constraint directly. So anyway, so the inverse problem has been resolved after more than 30 years from this old work. So I think that this should be a fundamental progress on the string theory formulation itself. So anyway, so now we know the fundamental origins for the general supergravities. So it would be interesting and significant to study the general supergravities seriously. And interestingly, the general type 3 supergravities and type 2 supergravities can be reproduced by taking special exception conditions for W series or exceptional W series. So anyway, so these general supergravities can be reproduced from W series or exceptional W series. And actually, the W series conversions is helpful to understand the nature of the extra vector field, capital I.
So T4 can be the solution?
T4, yes. Yeah, actually the T4 can be realized as Young-Box combinations with only modular classical matrices.
Right.
Actually, that was shown in my previous papers. Thank you so much. Yeah, so anyway, so capital I is related to non-geometric classes. Okay, so then, let's consider the implications of the appearance of the generalized supergravities. So we hope that there are a lot of the so-called pathological backgrounds which do not satisfy the ownership conditions of the standard supergravities in the old papers. So for example, non-aligned irregularities led to such backgrounds. This is very well known fact. So however, these backgrounds may be solutions for the generalized supergravity. So this is interesting observations. In fact, the Gasperini rich Venetian background, this background is obtained by performing a non-aligned equality, and this background is well known that this is not the solution of the usual classical supergravity, but this is a solution of general supergravities by adding appropriate capital I. So this is the result. So anyway, so this is the background constructed by Gasperini rich and Venetian. But this is not a solution to the standard type 3 supergravity or 3 supergravity. But by adding this capital I, we can see that this is a solution to the general supergravity. And along this line, more examples have been studied by Owen Polidan et al. So anyway, so this statement has been confirmed by considering a lot of examples. So anyway, I think that we can find or can rescue much more pathological background as solutions of the general supergravity. So this is an important message for my talk. So anyway, so any questions so far?
So the statement is generalized supergravity is a special case of gamma extra
recognition. Yeah, recognition is a special case of general supergravity. We can generate special solutions of the general supergravity as the Young-Box deformations of 80,000 square background. Actually, the these Bayesian solutions cannot be obtained as Yamazaki solutions, for example. Cannot. So anyway, so general supergravity is much larger than Yamazaki solutions. So from this viewpoint, Yamazaki solution is nothing but a solution generation techniques in the general supergravity. We can generate a lot of special solutions.
If I understand correctly, this this young Bachler deformation gives you a classical integrable model.
Yes.
Does it also give you a quantum integrable model?
I'm sure about the quantum integrability. Actually, no one knows. Yeah, actually, so in principle, we can consider the quantum integrabilities for arbitrary classical harmonics. But actually, the quantum integrability has not been studied. That is open for. So,
you said generalized
about the compound from beta function and other solutions. Okay, so probably that is related to the next sections. Okay, so I can probably go forward. So, okay.
25
minutes. Okay, I have 25 minutes for that. Okay, so then anyway, so let me make some comments on why the invariance of the inverse series theories whose time space time is given by a solution of general supergravity. Okay, so then what happens to the inverse series theories whose time space time is given by a solution of the general supergravity? So in this paper, so this statement is made. So when the background is given by a solution for the general supergravity, scale invariance is ensured, but while invariance is not given. So actually, so in this paper, appropriate counter terms have not been discussed so much, so seriously. So we decided to tackle this problem. So we try to look for appropriate counter terms by using the knowledge on the double field theory pictures. So this was very useful. So anyway, so this is our conclusion. So by allowing the dynamos to depend on the dual coordinates, we can construct a possible counter term. So anyway, so we discussed this counter term for the bosonic string case in this paper. So we have not considered the string, super string theory case, but in the case of super string theories, the analysis should be very complicated. Because we need to compute the beta function for Ramon-Ramon fields. So, but the essential part of the proof of wide invariance has been resolved in this paper. So, anyway, so let me show you our arguments on the wide invariance. So, okay, so here we consider the positive string theory in 26 dimensions. So, this is the usual classical function. So this is the metric and this is BP. So at classical levels, we can evaluate a trace of energy momentum tensors. And of course, we can see the value invariance at classical level. But at quantum levels, a trace anomaly appears. So this was computed by Shalai and Ward, and this is a very well known paper. So this is the beta functions. So here, then, let's remember the quantum scale invariance argument made by Poole and Townsend in 1986. So if the beta function takes this form, then scale invariance is preserved at quantum level. So this is the statement made by Poole and Townsend. So anyway, so G and I appear here. And of course, this G and I are closely related to general supergravity. So, of course, in the original papers, defined symbols were used, but I adjusted the symbols to fit our argument. Okay, so anyway, so the extra vector fields appears in the argument in the very old states in 1986. So, anyway, so if this vector function takes this one, so this position is satisfied for the super general supergravity part. So this is very important point. So anyway, so if we consider our solutions of general supergravity as a particle space, so then a quantum scale invariance is automatically ensured by following the argument. Okay? So anyway, so this data function, by using these data functions, we can invite a best analysis by using multiplication of motions of x, and we can invite this part into this form. So this is nothing but a total derivative. So quantum scale invariance is ensured. If beta functions are given by these ones. Okay, so then let's consider a special case of Coulomb-Townsend arguments. So let's say G and capital I. Capital I is zero and capital G is taken as derivative of Dirac. So then we can rewrite the trace anomalies into this form. So then, of course, by using the usual Dirac coupling, this time we sometimes call the first integrity term. By using this first integrity term, we can cancel out this trace anomaly. This is the usual argument, right? So anyway, so it's not here that this first integrity term is not including alpha prime here. So this sum is regarded as a quantum contribution. So that's why, so by taking a classical variations in terms of the large symmetric, we can cancel out the quantum trace anomaly. So anyway, so first integrity term is nothing but a quantum contribution. Okay, so then let's see a generalization of the plastic integrity term. So we like to generalize plastic integrity term to cancel out the right anomalies, trace anomalies, in the presence of non-trivial capital I. So this is our proposal. This is a proposal. So this is a counterpart we propose. So anyway, so this second part is shifted right. So this linear dependence is nothing but this linear dependence appears already in the generalized derivative rules proposed by Partition et al. So anyway, so they consider the general derivative rules as a supergravity level, but we are now considering the sigma whatever level, right? So in this case, so we need to add this linear dependence in advance by hand to the first integrity term. So then, by naively performing usual derivative, so we will get the sorry. The usual first integrity terms. So anyway, this modified first integrity term depends on the Dirac coefficient. So we need to remove the Dirac-Pontier dependence. So in order to remove this Dirac-Pontier dependence, we decided to use the equations of motions of the schools, the sigma modern equations of motions given by this one. So then, by integrating these equations of motions, we can remove this Dirac-Pontier dependence. So but so after removing this Dirac-Pontier dependence, this term becomes non-local. So anyway, so this generalized plasma integrity term becomes non-local. But anyway, by taking classical variations in terms of the world symmetric like this, so then we will get this contribution. So this is the opposite to the Coulomb-Townsend trace anomalies. So that's why we can exactly cancel out the Coulomb-Townsend trace anomalies by using this this modified first integrity term. So this is our result. So anyway, so I know that some people don't like these non-local terms because we need to explain these non-local terms somehow. Of course, these non-local quantum terms should be obtained by integrating some fluctuations in more fundamental theories. So then, other fundamental theory is non-local, so there should be no problem, I think. But we have no idea for such fundamental theories. So I cannot answer another question. But anyway, so by using this non-local counter terms, we can cancel out while place anomalies, even for solutions for general supergravity. So this is our conclusion. Okay, so then let me summarize my talk. So in this talk, I have given an overview of the Young-Back cycle formations of type 2B string theories defined on AES 565 background and their relation to general supergravities. So anyway, so through the study of integral deformations of AES 565 superstring, general supergravity was discovered. So anyway, so integral deformations led to the fundamental progress of string theory itself, I think. So anyway, so general supergravities was introduced by solving the capacitor constant of mutual string theory directories. So this is very fundamental. So then we can understand Young-Back cycle formations can be studied as solution generation techniques or solutions of general supergravities nowadays. And so string theories on general supergravities may be very invariant if we admit non-local contact. And so here, I did not mention, but this extravector field I in the general supergravities can be regarded as a non-geometric Q-flux. More precisely speaking, the phrase of non-geometric Q-flux. So non-geometric background can be realized as Young-Back cycle formations. As you said, T-board can be constructed as Young-Back cycle formations with non-minimodular classical analysis. But actually, the general solutions with non-minimodular classical analysis are non-geometric. So non-geometric background can be produced as solutions of general supergravity. This is also an interesting point. So as future directions, I can raise these differences. So it may be interesting to consider applications of general supergravity to plane level 3. So by including this non-geometric flux, one may consider flux compactification or transcape scenarios. And so we can generalize the already known scenarios by including this extra vector field. And then it may be interesting to consider graph force solutions. So graph force solutions have not been constructed in the general supergravity. So it may be interesting to consider graph force solutions and its entropies in relation to general supergravity. And the final one is a more ambitious one. So one may look for more fundamental formulations of superstring theories. So because in this case, general supergravity come from kappa invariant in superstring theories. But in superstring theory formulation is just an example of formulations of superstring theory, right? And actually, so in this case, phrase of non-geometric Q-flux appears. But of course, there are a lot of fluxes, geometric fluxes, non-geometric fluxes. So, but I don't know why phrase of non-geometric Q-flux is specialized in the Green-Schwarz formulation. So this result may indicate that there may be a more fundamental formulation of superstring theories, including geometric fluxes, non-geometric fluxes. So all fluxes are demographically included. So this is the final one. So anyway, so I have finished. So I will stop here. Thank you for your attention. Sigma models should be closely related to this general supergravity, probably by taking special exception conditions for these sigma models, probably general supergravity should be included. But it has not been done. Yeah. And actually, this final fundamental formation should also be related to the double sigma model formulation, I think.
Following the same direction of thinking, if you deform the organism of the by having a touch, I think you use a similar deformation in the time.
I'm sure. examples of solution generation techniques, right? So actually, yeah. So it's a huge progress. So some authors discussed that Yamato definition is nothing but a special example of data transformation in the context of WPF theories. So in the context of WPF theories, more general solution generation techniques are known. And Yamato definition can be realized as a special example of data transformation.
Is there
an extra
term you added in the action
was
linear in the dual coordinate?
Yeah, actually, this extra vector, field I, appears only in this quantum collection.
Is I constant? Or?
So I is constant. It depends on our treatment. So for this case, we usually take capital I, is taken as a beginning direction. Of course, that is not necessary. So in general.
But I guess what I was going to ask is, the two-dimensional curvature is a total derivative. You can pull out the e and take a derivative on the y tilde, and then use the then d of y tilde is can be written in terms of the fields of the sigma mode.
Yes.
So then somehow you can write the local action and the.
Yeah, in that case, yeah, we can just local quantum. Okay, so when sculpture is hidden in terms of total derivatives, so this counter term comes local. Yeah, I think so, yeah.
So it would be a term that it's, involves the local terms and the spin connection on the world chain.
Yes, I think so.
Well, I'm just saying that you can rewrite this term as a local term at the cost that is not manifestly coordinate invariant. But I think a coordinate transformation of the box would be D or something, so it might be something that cancels after you integrate the parts.
So, you mean Fourier transformations on the box sheet or?
Well, let's see. So, this term. So R, right, is D omega, right, D of the spin connection. So then you can integrate the D to the D y tilde, and then rewrite y tilde in terms of the fields of the problem, the local fields, which are the axes. So at the end of the day, you have a coupling which involves
invariant.